All right, well, thank you for doing this. I really appreciate it.
You're welcome.
And I want to just begin, I always begin just for the record, when and where were you born and raised?
Los Angeles, California, really? 1926.
Wow, and was it a very different place back then?
Well, I don't remember when I was born, but it was in a birthing hospital in a place called Lenox, which is, I pass a sign as you leave the airport if you're on Century, and it says Lenox, and you think, where is Lenox? But that was where that cottage was. They had moved down from the Bay Area, and my brother and sister were born up there, so I was the only one who made it to L.A.
And from what I've read, sort of when the Depression began, your family moved from closer to the...
Oh, yeah, actually, my father was a contractor, and he had built some homes, and I have some snapshots somewhere of those homes. I drive by them once in a while, and naturally, they've all been redone a million times. He was a contractor, and a friend of his was an architect, and they built these beautiful homes right on the important streets, Beverly Drive and et cetera. And so, but the crash came, and of course, I didn't know what that meant or anything about it, but I do remember in the kitchen, we were renting houses down here in Almont, actually, and we had to leave that house. So I remember thinking, what's going on here? So, you know, you don't know anything at that age, but we did leave in there, and we rented in different areas, and then finally we went over to the southeast side of town, and of course we had a wonderful time. You know, we had friends who also rented in the area, and we were close to the railroad tracks that head to the Coliseum, so we watched trains, there were fields, and it was amazing. So we had a great childhood. We even saw snakes in the grass, and you know, it was, and then haystacks on this field. And I remember one time these guys came in their truck to chase us away, and who was stuck on the top, you know. Anyway, it was quite a time. So we finally left there when I was about, not quite junior high age. So I went to Laurel, up here on Laurel Avenue, and then to Bancroft, and then to Fairfax.
And were movies a big part of your childhood? Did you go a lot?
No. We did go a lot. It was, my brother and I would walk all the way from, let's say, 7th Avenue, down to Jefferson and walk up toward Crenshaw, and there was a movie there. I saw a lot of musicals, you know, all those flying down to Rio. I don't know before that, but anyway, early on. So it would have been in the late 30s, I guess. So we'd go, but I never thought of being in the movies. It didn't enter my brain.
And so what is it that happened? I guess it was very young age where I believe you were working while in school and somebody saw you, or how did this begin?
Yeah, that is strange. I worked at Desmond's down here on Wilshire, but first before that I worked at Vandekamp's Bakery. I was one of those little blue cute costumes. And of course, it was up on Hollywood Boulevard beyond Vine, you know, down toward the next big one. Anyway, a lot of musicians would come in and kind of hit on you. I remember I was working there the day that the war, you know, we were bombed. It was like a horror story. And then, when I finally left there, I used to take a streetcar from Sweetser and Santa Monica, and it cut across, you're not familiar with this area, but Gardner and Santa Monica, and then would cut on an angle up to Sunset, which was really fascinating. So I would catch the streetcar and go up there and go to that place. But after that, I came back to my senses and got a regular job at Desmond's and, you know, that type of thing.
And Desmond's was like a high-end clothing store, is that right?
Yeah. You're too young to remember. It probably quit, I don't know when. Was Desmond's still around when you were a girl, honey?
Nope.
No. So there you are. It was a men's and women's store, and good sportswear and good reputation. Silverwoods was around then too, and that was similar. But anyway, several people said, you know, one guy finally was a little more forceful, and he took me around to see a few places.
Now, who was this guy? Who did how did he present himself? Who was he?
He was an agent, mm-hmm. and Chris, I think it was Hofel, and he took me around quite a bit, and one place was Goldwyn's, and so I ended up doing a bit for Goldwyn's on the Walter Mitty, if you can believe
yes,
it, it's
they
come
just,
full, say,
they
full
just
circle. And I got a job, and I was supposedly the secretary for his boss.
Danny Kaye's boss, yeah.
Yeah, and so then I was always a little bit fat, you know, heavy, and I had to always be at the gym working out. And I remember I got a call that day, and I went over there, and I had done that a little bit, and then I got a call saying that Mr. Goldwyn wanted to meet me, and I thought, ooh, that's something. So I don't know if you know where it is, on Santa Monica Boulevard, mm-hmm. and the Formosa mm-hmm. Bar was across the street, and his office was the one that jutted out front. So he asked me if I'd like to be a Goldwyn girl. He said the whole group had just gotten back from Europe, and you would read about them. This one was going out with this prince, and that one was dating this one, and this... So I said, oh, he said, but I'm sending them on a trip. You want to? I said, well, I really can't. I have a little girl. Uh-huh. And he said, oh, well, would you like to be in the movie? And I said, sure. So I went in, you know, and it was just...
This was for just a specific movie or in any movie?
No, that movie. It was that movie, and uh-huh. there were a bunch of girls, these girls. And I finally said to the casting man, are they making more money than I am? They're so snobbish, you know? We were all making the same, but
right.
you didn't really go to work right away. You went immediately to do PR. Mm-hmm. I mean, we went to the fraternity house in UCLA. You went to, there was a TV show, lots of little interviews, things,
yeah.
parades, you know, you'd be the queen of them, you know? Anyway.
Well, let me backtrack for 1 second and ask you, when this guy came to Desmond's, did you have yourself any desire to be an actress, or was this just something that...
No, it was the money. It was,
yeah.
I mean, we all came out of the Depression.
Yeah.
We were really broke,
yeah.
so the thought of making more money was very interesting.
So, but you had no independent desire to do this until... until it presented itself. There was no sort of childhood dream of being an actress.
No.
Okay, so now you started at, I guess, so initially Secret Life of Walter Mitty was at Goldwyn, but that was not, you were not under contract or anything to them. It was just like a
yeah.
one-time thing.
Right, but it also something going on at the same time was somebody else had seen me and I can't remember if it was Universal, wherever Bert, who was a big, handsome guy. He used to work with, when they were young, Kurt Douglas.
Oh, Lancaster.
Bert
yeah.
Lancaster. So he liked me. He wanted me to be in this movie, The Hawk and the Arrow or something. But they wanted me to have red hair, and I was never this color then. I was just brown. And... So they paid for me to go to Westmore's on Sunset at the big parlor once every, 3 weeks or something to do my hair.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, well, that's not bad. So, but I had to have this hair all the time, and so I don't think I ever got to work in that movie. But then I can't remember. Oh, I know. I don't remember how I got the job, but I went to work for... Bob Alden, Holiday in Mexico was the first one.
Yeah, because that's 1946 and Mitty's only 1947. So the first thing that you shot actually Holiday in Mexico?
Yes.
And that was also, that was where the guy who saw you at Desmond's, he took you to MGM?
No,
or how did that one come about?
Well, that was a funny deal. A friend of mine told me that the Cuga, I love to speak a little Spanish, mm-hmm. but I was imitating Lina Romay. She was mim bam boom, chiu chiu chiu, and all that. I memorized those because I loved them so. And he said, you know, they're rehearsing on Hollywood Boulevard. You know, those little storefront things beyond Vine. Do you want to go see? I think she was either retiring or whatever. She didn't want to do that anymore. I think she married a wealthy guy, mm-hmm. but what do I know? Anyway, so I said, sure. So I went there, and there was the whole orchestra, you know, just sitting around on portable chairs, and all, I can remember all the guys. Anyway, it was I met them, and I got up and sang Chiu Chiu and Bim Bam Boom and whatever I did, and then he said, well, I don't really need a vocalist right now, but I'm doing a movie at MGM. Do you want to be in it, singing and dancing? I said, sure. So that was that.
And when you say you got up there and sang with them, how how did that even come about? Because you said you just went down there to see it?
Oh, I went down there to see them rehearsing. And I don't know who suggested I get up and sing, but I...
That's great.
It's good with me. I loved it. You know, I loved that song. And so, no problem. So then they said, well, then come to MGM on a certain time. And they always had, the dancers were real dancers. Mm-hmm. And there's still some of my friends from those days. Mm-hmm. Most of them are gone. But and guys. And they were all nice. And Holiday in Mexico, my God. But there was a beautiful woman, Ilona Massey. Did you ever hear her?
I don't think so.
No, yeah, well, she was gorgeous. And she reminded me, she had a perfect, I had a beautiful mother, and she was similar to that. I mean, she was Scandinavian mm-hmm. of some sort. And she and I, and another creature, Linda Christian, who ended up marrying Tyrone Power. Do you know that whole story? Well, she befriended me. And I was living up on a duplex up on Sweetser and Waring. And Linda was living at the Bel Air Hotel. And so she picked... I was taking 3 buses to get to him, down Melrose to Fairfax, mm-hmm. down Fairfax to Washington, down Fairfax, you know. Mm-hmm. And so she would come and pick me up and take me to work. And I thought, that was a plus.
Yeah, yeah. So now you've had a couple of... film opportunities, Holiday in Mexico, Secret Life of Walter Mitty, I guess then Words and Music. At this point...
Words and Music was fabulous.
But before we even talk about that, I guess I'm curious, now that you had gotten into it, I know you're saying, you said you were not, it was never your ambition to be an actress, but now that you were, did you hope to be a star? Did you hope to...
Yeah.
It was just a steady gig that you liked?
To get some money.
No,
later on I got the acting bug, and then I started to study, but that was way after I did Paint Your Wagon and stuff.
Way
really
down
later.
So as far as now, you know, when you wound up meeting Samuel Goldwyn, and I guess that was after Secret Life of Walter Mitty?
No, he produced
it. You saw him, and that's what led to that?
Yeah.
What was he like? Because he's sort of one of the great characters people talk about.
Yeah, well, I don't remember too much about the conversation. Nothing, he wasn't as amusing, but I do remember he would come visit the set, and we'd all have our little outfits on, and they were, you know, décolletage or like what would you call one of those little... outfits that it's not panties.
Oh, like a lingerie type.
It was lingerie type thing. And he would come in and he would just study us. He'd go from one to the other. And he'd look at somebody and say, more rouge. More rouge. And you think, and we had this wonderful woman who was, I came into her later, Irene Sheriff or something like. She ended up, she did the costumes for that.
Yeah.
But she also did American Paris. So that was many years later that I ran into her again. It was wonderful.
So, and was there any, was there a perk to being a Goldwyn Girl? Did people who were Goldwyn Girls generally go on to bigger things, or was it just...
Oh, it was really a social thing, yeah. I think, because, it, you know, who is she? Oh, she's dating so-and-so. You know, there were, it was all the social yeah. end of it. Nobody... I mean, there were some famous Goldwyn Girls, like Paulette Goddard and Lucille Ball mm-hmm. and a few people, but, you know, that wasn't going to get you anywhere except a good boyfriend, I guess.
Okay, so... now, how is it that in the years sort of immediately after that, you wound up working so often at Paramount and MGM when without being under contract with them, right?
I know. It was interesting. I can't remember either, but I finally, I did so many things. First of all, go back up. We went to the modeling. I was with an agency who just handled modeling, posing for artists and that type of thing.
When did that begin for you?
I don't know.
But did it precede any of the movie stuff, or was it only after?
It was sort of in between. Yeah. In fact, you hear about her name, Ruth Snively. Marilyn Monroe was with her, so I probably saw her and didn't even know it at that time. And, you know, I got to work for some wonderful artists, but it was comical because one, living in L.A., there's two papers. There was the Times and the Examiner. Well, the Examiner hired this artist, Henry Clive, who was very important, and he could do, let's say, Marion Davies as Marie Antoinette. Mm-hmm. Well, so I would go to his home and pose, and... there were other artists, I can't think of the names right now, but I was so stunned one time to see his easel there and with a canvas on it, and it looked like there was a photograph on there, and I thought, you're kidding me, you know, he was painting over it, and I thought, I wonder if anybody else does this, mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm. And you think, shut up. But there were many times, and one artist I worked for, he was very close to being at Bullock's Wilshire, across the street, two-story office building, mm-hmm. And they sent over the wardrobe for, and Jane Russell had just become a star, and they sent all this wardrobe over from RKO, or, mm-hmm. And that's when Hughes owned it, and lingerie and the bra and everything, and I would pose for various pictures of her when they would advertise whatever's coming along.
So you would wear the Jane Russell, like, these outfits, and they would then use that to promote whatever she was.
Well, and then superimpose. I don't know. Yeah. I never saw them. I just know that's what I did. And there were other people. There was somebody who lived in Santa Monica, because I remember taking the bus down San Vicente. Anyway, but I had my share of that. And I even have some calendar. Well, I worked for, I'm blanking on the name. Who's the one who did the calendar for Marilyn?
Oh, yeah, Kelly.
Kelly.
Is it Tom Kelly?
Yeah, and his wife. They had studios right there on, just off Melrose on Seward. And I had done... something. I have a calendar in there, and for Pabst Blue Ribbon or mm-hmm. something. And so she came and took me by the hand and took me back to the bedroom. And over the bed was a painting, like a nude on velvet. Mm-hmm. Oh, we'd like to do this. I said, oh, I'm sorry. I can't do that. I'm a mother, you know. So I was... tease and say they asked me first.
Yeah.
They probably asked five other people too.
Well, but now, so had the Marilyn, that they showed you, was the one they showed you the Marilyn one? Or
No, that's what they wanted to do.
So Marilyn's hadn't happened yet.
Right.
Wow, okay. So, do you ever second guess that decision?
No, not at all. Can you imagine? I have a whole bunch of kids. Yeah. Can you imagine?
So, now, but as far as the Paramount and MGM thing, was there somebody at those studios who you were friendly with, or how did it just come to be that you were there so much?
I don't know. I think the thing is, some of those people were very generous. I worked for Lewis, Dean Martin and Lewis.
Yeah.
several times, and whenever I was on the lot or for an interview, I would visit to see if there's somebody working that mm-hmm. I know. And usually it'd end up you get something, because mm-hmm. I worked a lot for them. And I can't remember, but I did a bit on some movie with... gosh, I could probably remember the name.
I know you did these five with Esther Williams, which is pretty...
Oh, that's at MGM.
At MGM. Oh, are we talking Paramount still?
Yeah.
Paramount.
Who's Got the Action? Was a...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I was in that, playing, I don't know, somebody's girlfriend, probably, but these things are so small, is that a girlfriend, or is that a... Yeah. But Breakfast at Tiffany, the funny part about that is that recently, within the last, about a year, somebody was bringing, there was a, I don't know, 50 year or whatever, so somebody was going to shoot this, they took the party scene, in fact, I have a picture in here, they brought the people back, the one, Marvin Page, he just
died. Oh, yeah,
died.
Marvin Page.
He called a bunch of us and he said, we're going to do this, da da da, and they're going to pay us. And we're going to shoot that scene night for day, you know,
yeah.
day for night, at a home out in the Woodland Hills or somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So we all got together and they had hors d'oeuvres and drinks and everything, and we shot it. And then they interviewed each one of us.
That's great.
On camera to put this in with this, when people buy that disc.
That's
you know,
great.
I never saw the whole thing, but I did have a picture of it. But it was fun because they got to interview us, and I remember shooting that scene, and it was so funny. The guy who played the comic, he had like hair, it was kind of poppy color.
Mm-hmm.
And there was the room, I don't know if you remember, there was the cat.
Mm-hmm.
It was called the cat.
Yeah.
And the cat would walk along there, and there were books. And so one time, the cat is supposed to jump down. We jumped down, and the actor was so angry. He said, "The damn cat scratching me." It's like they called the cat wrangler.
Yeah.
The cat wrangler came over, looked at the cat.
He would bite him?
They never even killed the lights. We went on.
Oh, my
gosh.
They
shot the thing, and he didn't get hurt the
wow.
next time.
Oh, so he was, like, getting his nails? Is that what it was? Or
claws were
yeah.
going into the shoulders
yeah, so they
of
cut,
the actor.
He,
so the guy bit
he,
them
he
off.
He bit the claws off. Oh, my gosh. Well, that's funny. And so that was Paramount. And then, and actually, probably another person I imagine you may have known there who just passed away, A.C. Lyles, was always...
Well, he was always there. He,
yeah.
you know, he called everybody. He used to call me. He used to call my cousin, who was the accountant from Bing Crosby. He was a... Yeah.
Yeah.
Some people you just, you know... He was a player. Let's
oh, is that right? Is that right?
You didn't
No, that's funny. So now you also had, I guess, somewhat overlappingly, all this stuff at MGM. And including, let's just to touch on first, the Esther Williams movies.
Yeah, but that was funny because I can't remember. I think it might have been Helen Rose, but no. Yeah. Well, anyway, I was hired to do a modeling on that film on a diving board, and that's
for Neptune was the
yeah.
first okay Neptune's Daughter yeah.
And then we heard there was an audition at 3:00. Hey, do you want to go? Sure, let's go. Well, you were all beach, you know, some of us are beach rats. So I'm not a great swimmer, but if you could practically swim across the pool, you got the job, and I got the job. So that led to many more, but you got to know all those people. But it was just wonderful working there, because can you imagine walking along the hall and you know Bronislaw Kaper or some of these magnificent composers,
mm-hmm.
you know them by the first name, Hiberana, you know. It just, I was very impressed.
And
people were wonderful. Arthur Freed was the producer. He hired me for everything.
And what was he like?
Oh, he was a sweet man, you know.
Because a lot of people say that MGM, during the Golden Age, the best musicals were MGM dominated the genre, and he was the sort of kingpin of that.
Yes, and he surrounded himself with very, very bright people. I mean, who is the young composer, conductor who went to London and, oh, you know.
I know who you mean. And yeah. I also know Comden and Green were there with him a lot, and yes. a lot of those guys.
Yes, they were.
Now, but people would, you were often sort of right next to Esther Williams, and people sometimes couldn't tell you apart, right? Is that true?
No.
I've read that somewhere. Where did you look a little like her?
Well, by the time you put your makeup on and pull your hair back in, I guess there's a similarity. I have a picture here, you'll see.
Yeah. But she was pleasant, now, you know, especially after time of working with her?
Oh, yeah, she was very pleasant. I think she didn't see as well as she should, because oftentimes when you think somebody's not saying hello, mm-hmm. it's probably their eyesight, yeah. you know. You know, she was fine. In fact, I learned more about her from the book that she wrote. Mm-hmm. I thought, oh, my God, what she went through with that Ben Gage who mortgages the house, and oh, my God. Mm-hmm. And then she ends up marrying Fernando, and Fernando didn't want the children around, so they had to live over there. She's here. She would go over and help him with the homework and make the dinners. And you think, okay.
Yeah, explain some things.
But it was Fernando. I got to work on a commercial with his son.
Oh, yeah,
and I
Lorenzo.
Told him that I had worked with Esther. And he spoke very highly of her. I thought, well, that's good.
Yeah.
I want to hear from the kids.
Yeah, right. Now, another kind of controversy that's been recorded through history that you had a front row seat to was what happened with Judy Garland on Annie Get Your Gun.
Well, that was so sad because we didn't really know. We just saw the action. We started to film it, and Minnelli mm-hmm. was directing it. And, you know, she would be in the dressing room, but and she would take time to come out, and you never knew. We heard that somebody would give her a shot or something like that, but she was lovely, and I got to watch a lot of it, but then finally it came to an end. And it wasn't until...
She was fired, is that right?
Well, I guess we didn't actually hear the details, but she was replaced mm-hmm. by Betty Hutton. Well, it wasn't until, maybe 5 or 8 years ago, I finally looked at the tape. I have a disc of... Mm-hmm. And I thought, my God... She was wonderful, Betty Hutton, and mm-hmm. we all just really disliked her. She was a needy person. She needed yeah. lots of love. And you think, why would they use her instead of Judy? Well, you know, there's no way Judy Garland could have done that film.
Because she was on so many drugs or whatever it was?
Well, I don't know about that. It's just that Betty Hutton was just perfect yeah. for that role.
Was Judy already married to Minnelli at that time, or was that...
No, they got... I don't know if they were married, but let's see. I remember working on Bells Are Ringing when I first saw the child come in. I don't know when Lisa was born.
Yeah. But it must have been a little awkward to have your... Even if they were just dating, to have to replace your girlfriend or wife.
No, it was... who knows
yeah.
what happens.
And then, okay, so now a lot of people say of these great MGM musicals, there are few that are in the same league as An American in Paris. And so what was your role there, and what was your experience on that movie?
Well, it was wonderful because I knew, you know, everybody, because we'd done all these things, you know the crew, you know, the makeup people, you know, everybody. And then Gene Kelly, my friend for life, worked opposite me on the stair. And so we had lots of funny times together. And including, we first met on Annie, mm-hmm. dressed together. And on that one, you know, at that time, you went in there and you got your makeup on and you did as you were told. And they wouldn't let you go home, even if you knew you weren't going to be used again or something. So we would get into trouble. We would trade clothes. We would get the makeup man to do something. And we'd borrow mustaches or and come in pigeon-toed. Now, yeah, let us go home. Yeah. And they would finally. But things got better. Finally, it got to a point later where they would have some sense about letting you go home or come.
Because this was only a year after Annie Get Your Gun, American in Paris. So I guess having worked with him back to back, it was pleasant working with Kelly.
Well, yes, of course. And he was so helpful. I mean, really? I'm not really a dancer, although I've taken dance classes most of my life. And but he would teach us how, he came from Broadway, so he would teach us how to come down the stairs without looking down. And I mean, here you got a headdress on, how are you going to drop your head down? So you would take a step and then you'd kick it and you'd feel it with your foot. You'd feel the rise up behind it and you'd put your weight down. I still do that when I cross the street to go to my office in Beverly Hills, you know, kick, so you don't have to constantly be looking down. So I always admired him for that, but he was really clever.
And your scene that you're referring to in that movie is where, can you remind the context of coming down the stairs?
Oh,
and all that?
That is the big staircase number. Mm-hmm. I'll build a stairway to paradise. This was a Frenchman singing, yeah. Georges Guitari, I think.
And I just have to mention, I don't know, did you get to know Leslie Caron during the making of that?
I remember when they first brought her over, and I thought she doesn't even know it, that she is the one who started this, you know, when you would see girls with little, I can't remember what we used to call them, those stockings that go up to your knees.
Oh, like leggings or whatever?
Knee socks?
Well, maybe so, but they were workout clothes, and uh-huh. they sometimes...
Oh, leg warmers.
Leg warmers. Oh my God! So she would come and she was amazing. And they put her up with her mother, I think, across mm-hmm. the street. You know the side entrance where the mm-hmm. funeral parlor mm-hmm. was there, and across the street was a motel, and that's where they put her up. Class. Huh?
Well, it's so funny because I just in May. I covered the Cannes Film Festival for The Reporter, and then I set up two interviews in Paris that I really wanted to do, and they were Olivia de Havilland and then also Leslie Caron. And so we were talking about this, and actually she mentioned the motel that her mother and all that, so it's very funny.
It's so cute.
Yes.
But she was always sweet, and I thought I'd love to reminisce with her sometime. But
yes.
She would come on there and hear all these strangers, and she was such a good dancer.
Well, I'll leave you her email address if you want to correspond. But now, okay, I know a big thrill for you from what I've read in terms of the working at Paramount was doing a road movie with Bing and Bob, right?
Oh my God, yes, that was funny, and don't ask me how, because I'd done a lot of little parts on a lot of little things there, so I know the casting people, mm-hmm. and I don't know how I ended up on it, but... there were, I don't know, a group of us. I have a picture somewhere of some of us sitting around. And so some of the dancers were truly dancers, and they could do the whole number. I wouldn't even attempt it. And so we would be sitting around a table. And I don't know, there were strange costumes.
There's
a headshot. But,
sure.
You know.
And were Bing and Bob Hope fun to work with? Were they pleasant?
I've worked with them both many times. I'm trying to think where... Bing was really wonderful and he had a great sense of humor, and Bob Hope was... I had worked with him several times, and I don't even know, probably before that.
And Dorothy L'Amour?
I didn't get to know her, mm-hmm. but my cousin knew her very well. She was Bing's account, so they were friends, uh-huh. and she ended up giving my cousin clothes and things like that.
Huh. So I think of all the, of all the movies that you were a part of, one of them that certainly, I think maybe the one that gets watched the most is Rear Window, because Hitchcock and all of that.
Oh, it's too funny, because I have another daughter, and she said, I see you there, and I don't think so. Anyway, we got hired for that, and I was supposed to be one of the gals on the roof where the helicopter was, and they were supposedly watching us. But being on that film was such fun, because we had to come in every day, and we would get into trouble. They had some portable dressing rooms on the street outside. And Ross Bagdasarian, who You know, he's a chipmunk son. He's the one who had the chipmunks and the... Do you remember the chipmunks?
I don't.
Colleen? You're not Colleen. Diane?
No,
remember
no.
The chipmunk son?
Oh, the... Yeah, sure. Yeah.
That was him. Anyway, he was the piano player in the scene. If you ever see that movie, Rear Window.
Yeah, and of course.
You show the poor...
Of course, yeah, lady. Yeah. He plays the same song over and over and over.
Yeah, the poor lonely lady there, and you got to know all these
characters.
Yeah,
of course.
And watch all these people, and Grace Kelly. Oh, and that was the best thing about the funniest thing. I got to know Grace, you know, from seeing her every day, and she had a hairdresser named Weaver. And we'd be... They had a kind of a... Not the real... hairdressing outfit, but they would have a small room or something, and I remember sitting across Grace one time getting her hair done, and she said, "Sue, what does your husband do?" And I said, "He's a film editor." And she said, "Oh." And I, the next week she was engaged to the prince. Good timing. How can you top that?
No, well, I gathered that you... Well, first of all, let's just say, even though it was such a relatively small part that you say you're not necessarily able to even spot yourself,
yeah,
you were there throughout a long part of it, the shoot, right?
Yes, and watching him shoot and Hitchcock get behind a couch and get this angle and do it, and watch everything because, you know... And watch her wonderful wardrobe that she had, and it was fun.
Now, why though? And tell maybe this is not an uncommon experience if you're doing bit parts. I don't know, but why, if you're in a relatively small part of the movie, would you be there for so long on the set?
I know. No, as the movie business got older, mm-hmm. they got smarter, and they think, wait a minute, she's only going to be used, blah blah blah, and let's just hire her for X days. So. You know, they weren't thinking economically.
They were just, in case they needed you, they kept you around.
Yeah.
Got it.
And that happened a lot.
Yes.
Thank goodness.
Yeah. Because I was going to say, I mean, could a person, if you had not, I don't know when chronologically you got married, but could a person independently live on being an extra, essentially? Or would you have had to have supplemented that?
Oh, I see. As an extra, if you had every day as an extra, you'd be fine. A lot of people did. I knew a lot of them. In fact, I did a stint for a while. I signed up as an extra because you have to go to central casting and you had to call them and all that. In fact, I have a picture with Raoul Walsh. Do you know who he
was? Of course. Great. I think he had an eye patch, right?
Yes. Yeah, and there's a picture of him and I'm in it somehow, and I was the most beautiful extra in Hollywood, according to him.
That's great.
So I thought, well, there was an extra.
That's terrific. But you did not, though, you're saying until you registered with, was I guess, the Screen Extras Guild, which existed then. But, like, with prior to that, you were a free agent, and would you consider yourself an extra, or how would you have presented yourself to people that you met?
Oh, I don't think one would use the word extra if you... You know, there was a whole group that usually stuck together. They knew what they were doing. They were called at a certain time. And I usually, when you're working on a musical or something, you know you're going to be there X amount of weeks or months or whatever it turned out to be. So you got to know, you know, like at MGM, you would see Astaire come in and you know he was working here, or you would, you know, Pan... His choreographer.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God.
What's his... Oh, Hermes. Yeah.
So you knew all these people, but you don't think about... I wasn't thinking economically
at
that time.
And was it something that you enjoyed doing, or was it...
I loved it. Are you kidding? Yes.
And what's kind of amazing, thinking in the terms of how it works today, is that until... pretty far into your career, from what I've read, you did not have an agent. So how is this all coming together?
I know. It's funny because I got a commercial. Oh, I know. I was at MGM working on something. And there was, on the next set, they were doing a commercial. And I thought, a commercial? Let me go peek, you know. So then I decided, well, that sounds good. Because, you know, I had a lot of children and I wanted... mostly to be home, but I, you know, and try to figure it out. And I got a commercial agent, and that's Bob Longnecker. And so then I got him. I said, look, I've worked on this and I worked on this. So he took me, and then I got a regular agent for acting.
And but prior to that, because that's already into the late 60s, let's say, maybe roughly, right? So prior to that, how would you get all of these jobs that we've been talking about? Is it really just relationships with the casting directors, or?
Yes, actually, in a sense. In fact, on, what was it, Camelot? No. Paint Your Wagon. I worked on Camelot.
Mm-hmm.
And because I don't know, somebody was either an assistant director or a friend of the dancers. We'd all known each other. Mm-hmm. And so he, I don't know, either he called me or had somebody call me. And I got to work. Oh, and I got the job with on Camelot, mm-hmm. playing Vanessa's best friend, Lady Sybil, yes. or something. But I mean, that was a kick working with her because she's a really wonderful character. Yeah. But anyway.
But really, you must have been a great networker, though, to do this all without an agent and to be working at all with. So you pretty much worked nonstop for a lot of years, right? Except when you had your kids, and I know the commercials then came into the picture. That was a little better, but I mean, I just am, the thing that amazes me is that you could get this kind of work in many quality things without ever having real representation.
Yeah, I did have an agent, Sam Armstrong. He was an old timer.
That was early, before you had the other agent.
Now, who's the other agent?
Well, the one that for commercials and stuff.
Oh, yeah, commercials is a separate thing. That didn't come on until like 59 or something.
But so this other guy was even earlier than that?
I wish I could remember, but I don't. Anyway.
Well, that's fine.
For instance, my friend Judy was, Keith, she was married to Brian, family, you know, Brian Keith.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And she was a dancer.
Mm-hmm.
And then he had the show of the family.
Oh,
the
yeah.
Family Affair?
I know what you mean.
I think
yes,
I,
it was Family
yes,
Affair.
Yes.
Okay, well, then I got on that.
Oh, yeah. I read this.
Yeah.
And that's where that was sort of the beginning of you getting having an agent for television stuff at that point.
Yes.
Well, we'll come. We can.
Yeah, I can't remember exactly. Then I'm aged.
No. So here's something that kind of I was curious to ask you because I looking over all these credits. Often, they were, as you say, showgirls or models or sort of beautiful girls in the room. And I just wonder, was it more flattering or frustrating to be in those kind of parts? Because I'm sure, did you have ambition to do other kinds of things?
I didn't, but it was finally, in the midst of somewhere in there, I got, things were submitted to me, and I thought, I don't know how to do that.
You mean like other kinds of parts? Or
yeah, something where you go crazy or something.
Oh, really?
How do you do that? So then I went to UCLA Night School and took a class.
For acting?
Yeah.
Wow.
And then I went to the teacher there. He had an outside class at a little theater on Pico in Westwood area. So I went there, and he was talking about the method and all that. And I thought, oh my God! So I learned all that, and then he said, "Don't you ever get mad?" And I, because my mother was the sweetest thing in the world, and she never raised her voice or anything. And then I remember this one coming back on the back of a motorcycle or something, and I got mad. So then I started remembering some of these things, and yes, I can get mad.
So you would then use that when you were trying to use the method to get into a part or something.
Right.
So did you enjoy that kind of acting, or did you feel like it's the heck with it?
No, I enjoyed it. In fact, I liked it so well. I was going to try out Picnic was playing at the little theater on, Poinsettia and Melrose area. And they were going to replace the cast, and I was going to be the mother. And I don't know if you remember the film.
Yeah, of
Was it Kim
course. Yeah,
Newman?
Kim Novak, yeah.
And Nick Nolte was the boyfriend, or
Oh.
the stranger who comes to town. And so we were a replacement cast for this group, and there was another guy there, I can't think of his name right now, but he had won some local award. And so it was interesting because it's a whole different side. And I thought, oh, this is amazing. I think I can do that. And so I told my, and then I grayed my hair every night. I would take the white stuff and brush it through my hair. And I was so proud of myself to get that job. And my
Yes.
mother was still alive. And I think it was Johnny, my son, who came and he cried. And he said, "Oh, you made me cry." And I thought, oh,
That's
"I'm
great.
wonderful."
Yes. And so that was just sort of, I guess, a totally different kind of experience than what the kind of acting you'd done up to that point, right?
Right. I figured, it was all on, before, it was just on the surface. You weren't thinking it through. You think, Jesus Christ, how did I ever get any work?
Yeah. So, now for, I guess for let's see here. In the mid to late 60s, there were a couple of very exciting ones that you've referenced, Camelot, Paint Your Wagon, some others. Were any of those particularly, as you look back, did one stand out as a particularly favorite experience or a movie that you're proudest of?
Oh, well, the Paint Your Wagon was a kick. I mean, only because I was hired, I thought, for a small part, which I was, and was going to shoot up in Baker, Oregon, and they built the whole city. I was in a small city. And my kids were at home, and so my daughter from Boston came out to watch over them, even though I was married. You couldn't do that to somebody. So, anyway, Josh was. Logan was fighting with Lee Marvin, and you'd see the people on the street. I want to go home. Just don't get into it. And so it was a fun time. You make friends and you have a really good time. But I should have been there 2 days, and I was there like 2 weeks.
Wow.
It was just forever. But that was outstanding, and you watched. So much going on. I mean, Clint Eastwood was, he would say he was with somebody and you think, oh, shut your mouth.
So now, one of the things that must kind of amaze you, and I think that because I know you did so many different projects, that one of them that would be remembered as long as it has been and discussed as much as it has been is The Beach Girls and the Monster.
Oh, please, it has, because when we did it, having been a swimmer, it doesn't matter to me to come in and out of the surf or anything like that. But I was doing a commercial on the same street, and this same little company down to the street from Tom Kelly on the other side. And they did a lot of commercials there, and I did over 200 commercials, so I know what I'm doing. And this gal who had gone to high school with me at Fairfax, she said, and she was a voiceover.
This
She
is
was,
Joan Janice.
yes, and she was amazing. And she said, my husband and I are going to do a film, and we're having a reading on Sunday, and I need to cast the wife. And do you want to come and see? And I said, sure. Well, John Hall was going to be the truth of the matter is, I think John Hall owned a lot of stock.
Stock
And
footage.
yeah, so they were going to use this crash of the Mercedes at the end, probably. So they got him as the director and the lead. And now I come into that, not knowing anybody except Joan. So it was wonderful. We shot it to so many places. One was a house up on the hill in Brentwood area. One was house on the Malibu on the street. I think that was John Hall's ex-wife, and it was really a kick.
And was it? What was the budget on this? I mean,
I would have no idea.
But was it? It was pretty minuscule,
oh,
right?
Oh yes, yes. In fact, we signed our lives away, so we didn't really make anything then. We eventually got something, but not much. But it didn't matter.
And you kind of, there were no frills to this. You guys were doing your own makeup and hair and stuff, right?
Yeah, and doing a good job of it, by the way. Yeah. God! Oh, that reminds me, but it got me two other jobs, and one of them was really funny because the kids got to go. One was a movie that we did in Georgia, the Okefenokee Swamps. Can you think of the name of that? Was Swamp Country?
Yeah, Swamp Country, yeah.
Swamp Country. Oh, okay. Well, anyway, they put us up in Waycross, Georgia, in a hotel. Small hotel.
Yeah.
And the kids were always using the elevators, et cetera, et cetera. And, oh, my God, it was a... I can't remember if it was a producer or the... Somebody punched somebody out, you know, and then the makeup man... I ended up doing the lead's makeup one day with coffee and pancake. Oh, you know, you learn to do a lot of things in this business. And anyway, but from, I know, when I agreed to do that, they were going to fly me and my kids to Massachusetts. My daughter was having a child.
That's what was in Massachusetts?
Yeah. So I did that, and then we flew home, but also I got another movie out of that was Never Steal Anything Wet. I play this artist who's able to copy important works in my studio on the boat. So we went to Catalina to shoot that, and they had a wonderful time, you know.
Now, why do you think that movie has such a following?
Well, I don't know, except my niece called me from Oregon. They love it. They play it all the time for all their friends. But at the time, my boys were teenagers, and their friends would call, and they said, "Do you want to go surfing?" And they said, "No, I have to stay in and sculpt Vicky." Now, because this John Hall's son had been in an accident with his best friend, and the son must have been driving, because now we have the son living at the house who's got a terrible limp.
Yeah.
And he was played by Walker Edmondson, who was famous for being Beanie and Cecil cartoons, and he was very clever. He's the one, so he would sculpt me, Vicky.
Yeah.
But the teenagers would call and say, "Hi, is Vicky there?" You know.
They would call your house and do that. Wow.
Now my niece and nephews are doing that from Oregon because they've fallen in love with it all over again.
And, I mean, I guess one of the things is that people couldn't believe that, I mean, just trying to read, you know, from some of these books that have been written about her, that they couldn't believe that you would have a son that age. You look too good. How is that possible? Too young and too...
yeah, that's wonderful. Anyway,
yeah, it was just a crazy thing. And do you remember seeing it in theaters or seeing it on a big screen?
Well, yes, in theaters, because when it came out, I can't remember, we were in a bus or a private car, but we drove up to some different towns to see it at drive-ins or somewhere for a PR thing.
Mm-hmm.
It was a comedy. It's hard for me to even think sensibly about that film because, you know, and then they say, "Well, when you did that walk down the hall," and I think, "Oh my God, yes." And that was my own dress and my own shoes and my own makeup, you know.
Well, when you were shooting it, or when you saw it, when did you first realize this might be a amusing kind of a movie, that it would, you know, it was a little campy in the sense, like, I'd read that one time you saw sort of when you were watching the screening and there was some of the blood or something, you realized this...
Oh, that was another film where the blood was wrong, and that was the one in Georgia.
Oh, that was Swamp Country.
That was a guy,
I see.
He had escaped or something, and he did... I thought, oh my God, that red is purple. It's not blood, you know, and I said something, and obviously they never changed it, so I don't remember anymore about that.
But with
do you remember when you came home when I was about six and she was in the makeup from Monster and the Beach Girls?
Oh my God.
You woke me up and you warned me. And then she showed
up. Oh, with the scar and the blood.
Yeah, I had to drive home, you know, from wherever we were.
Oh, my God.
And Chris was in a tub or something, I think, at that point. And I said, "Woohoo, it's Mama, don't be frightened. I've got a terrible scar." You know, I was afraid to drive home. What if a policeman saw me? You know, but it was a beautiful scar. And it was on the cover of something. Well, it doesn't matter. Well, it's one of the reasons why it didn't make any sense. I live on the beach, or I did at the time, and my one son is a surfer. But here, they're sitting around chatting, and the surfer's a little. And then they turn, and there's this big... please, what can you say after that? It's just an embarrassment.
But it obviously led to a few other jobs, and in this weird way, it's immortal.
Oh,
and
it
so
is
it worth it in the grand scheme of things? Are you happy you were a part of it?
Oh, yes, I am. It's been a kick. Who would have ever thought?
And again, I guess it was part of this trio of drive-in B-movies that are pretty remembered, Swamp Country and Catalina Caper as well, and so... not bad to have, even if it's a strange section of film history.
Exactly. Yeah. In fact, we tried to get the movie, and I have a couple of gay friends, and we were looking for it and calling around, and there was some place up in Hollywood nearby and somewhere, and they found it, and some they went in there and they said something about they're buying it for a friend. She played in the. You know Vicky. I mean...
That's great. Well, you know, it's actually, as far as Beach Girls, the Monster is now on YouTube, on the internet, so anybody can watch it at any time.
How do you do that?
You type in... I just watched it this morning.
You're kidding.
Yeah, no, I did.
YouTube, I don't see...
I'll show you on my phone. We'll do it, we'll get it up in one second. Yeah, but I mean, isn't that... It's unbelievable. People are... And there's... Hundreds of comments. And
there's a wonderful character woman. She wrote, she's done so many things, but she wrote the music for one of the popular TV shows of the last 10 years. Anyway, Allie Willis.
Mm-hmm.
She's a real character. I mean, she met me at a party. My makeup man friend, he said, "Oh my God, Allie, and that whole group, she's belonged to this crazy people like Raoul, Paul, and people like that. She has a whole line of ceramics and all crazy things." Well, my God, she wanted to meet Vicky, and now she's been emailing me for years, and I've seen her several times, but I mean, I can't keep up with her. She's so famous. She went back to Detroit and led the band, and you know she's written all these songs. I want to say, "Sex in the City," but no, "Friends." The theme for them, "Friends," she wrote, and she's written a million things.
Huh.
But anyway, her name is Allie Willis, Allee.
I'll check it out.
She's a character.
So one of the things here at some point, I know you began this. A very successful career as a real estate agent. How did that enter the picture?
Well, that entered the picture early on. Well, first of all, I told you my father, but I've never talked much about that, who built these homes. But years later, he died. Suddenly, he fell out of a tree helping somebody. Yeah. So then years later, my mother remarried, and then he was from Oklahoma, and... He had a real estate license, and it was over by the Mormon temple, small office. He wanted all of us to get a license. So there were three children on my mother's side and three on his side. So we had, so everybody had to get a license. And so I did, and I thought, what will I do when this leaves me? I better figure out how to earn some money, you know. And so I did, and then my clients were commercial agent, Bob Longnagel, and I tried to sell something to my other agent, Commercials Unlimited. She's a gorgeous woman, Sonia Warren Brandon. And I tried to sell her a little house south of Wilshire and Beverly Hills. Oh no, it's too much money. You know, from that little house, which was probably four something, and the next year was seven something, and the next year, it just kept going up. So I thought, what do you know?
Right. And you enjoyed, did you continue? I know that you have acted while, in more recent years, but I mean, was it something that did that become your primary focus, or was it always a balance?
No, it wasn't always a balance. So mostly it's been real estate for the last few years, and once in a while, like on American Beauty, I can't remember how I got that. I had done a few things. In fact, there were small parts that would come up, and they'd ask you to go out for a reading. And on that case, I was mixing it up with another one. I went in. She's a pretty big person. I can't think of her name now, but she's done a lot of stuff. She was on a building at Wilshire and La Brea High Rise.
A casting agent, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I had gone there for the audition, but so I got a call back, and I went in there, and I went to the desk, and the copy was there, and I picked it. I said, "Oh, I'm sorry. I think I'm not in the right place. I think I was supposed to be a grandmother out having lunch with my grandkids or something." "No, you were going into a see how so I had I was really screwed up. I got the wrong outfit on and
Yeah.
everything. I was in, so it turned out to be American Beauty. And the funny part about it is Annette Bening, whom I really think is a wonderful actress and a great voice. But she was playing a real estate lady, which
Yes.
tickled me. And so I could hardly contain myself while we were shooting because the husband who was playing the part, he comes in with me and he said, "Well, it's pretty dark." And, "Oh no, in the morning this place just fills with sun." You know, and I thought, "Oh boy, oh, good luck, honey." And so that was her play. And I thought it was such a cute premise that somebody would write about real estate like
But
that.
when you did that audition, you left there thinking it's not gonna happen, right?
Exactly.
So how did you, so then you got a call or something?
Yeah, I can't remember. And I thought, oh, I guess I did something right.
And it is pretty amazing that, I mean, first of all, you had been in a Best Picture Oscar winner 48 years before, that also happened to have American in the title.
That is
And now
something,
48
yeah.
years later, here you are with another one that wins Best Picture with.
Isn't that amazing?
It is
But
pretty.
you were, I don't know if you have a list with you, but you were saying some of those films that I had been in may have been nominated.
Yeah, I have to, I may have been incorrect on the ones in between, but these, I mean, I don't know that many people have been in Best Picture winners that many years apart. It's true. It's honestly, I don't. I think maybe Kath. I don't. I'm thinking maybe somebody like Katharine Hepburn, or there's very few people that would have done that.
That's funny because when you said Catherine, I thought you were going to say Grayson because I worked with Mario Lanza and Catherine Grayson on one picture, and he was a rascal. And he was always, making her. Anyway.
Well, so looking back at all of these projects that you've been a part of and everything, do you feel that, well, first, before I even ask that question, I think there's a funny story about when you went to see American Beauty. I've read that you said you've told a story about seeing it for the first time, I guess, at the premiere.
Oh yes, I was. I read it and I thought, "Oh God, this sounds like a porno movie." Because you see in there, you're reading it. This girl's in the tub with flower petals all around it, and then, what is he doing if he's in the window? And what's your mind is racing, your head thinking, "Oh God." So I was so surprised that it won the Best Picture, although my kids loved it. I don't know if you ever saw American Beauty. Yeah, that's the way.
And but when you, I guess, did they edited your scene a little bit more than you thought they were going to? Was there something with that?
It was a very small scene, and they probably did. Oh, I'm sure they did. What am I thinking?
Because I remember there was one of these stories where I think you went with your son to see it for the first time,
Yeah.
and were a little taken aback at what they had done with as far as editing it.
Oh, maybe so. I
But
can't
it's
remember
yeah,
now.
not important.
Yeah.
But that's a pretty cool distinction to have been in two Best Picture Oscars. There's only been 85 so far, so that's not bad. Anyway, so looking back, it seems like you really enjoyed it and you were content about it. And I wonder personally, and maybe this is just being silly and not being from the industry or whatever, but you never being a star was never super important to you?
No, it wasn't, because, you know, we got to know a lot of them very well. Mm-hmm. And you think, God, you know, it's not something to be envious of, because they all had their problems.
Mm-hmm.
Not they all, but so many of them didn't. Yeah. You know, it didn't matter. You had your own life, which was pretty good.
Yeah. And so as you look back, is there something, some project or some fact or some event that you're proudest of, that you want, that you hope, you know, if you would like to have sort of front and center in your own memory, I guess?
I don't think so. I keep thinking there's going to be another one coming, a better one.
That's good. Are you still acting?
I would like to be. Yeah. I haven't been invited on any interviews lately, but I'm smarter now than I used to be.
As far as generally and approaching acting, probably, yeah, it makes you a better actor.
I think so, yeah. You look for different things.
Mm. Well, maybe, hopefully this will lead to more calls. They got to take advantage. I have to say, I think you look fantastic, and you obviously seem to still have the passion for it. They should get on it. So anyway, I really appreciate you doing this.
Thank you.
I appreciate it.
I'm honored that you did.
Thank you.